Hello and welcome to the Research Connection Podcast, the show that brings current expertise and cutting-edge research and connects it with users in the community.
Hi everyone, welcome back. We're here again with Tim and Paul. And Jackie, take it away.
The connection between hockey culture and how it is part of, we would all, or most of us would recognize it as part of the fabric of Canadian society. Right? And I sort of think that there's a connection between that culture and how it stays and the resilience of the narrative and how it stays as part of who we are as Canadians. And what implications does that have for hockey players, for girls and boys coming up through the hockey system and learning to play the game?
Well, how do we change something that, I mean, you alluded to it, that hockey's part of our, you know, our fabric. So how do you change something that's fundamental to our national identity? I think the players themselves, you know, they've evolved, they've changed. I think it, you know, they change as society changes, because I mean, just like what Tim said, you know, they are a part of the world. Mm-hmm. Right now, it's just that, you know, has it changed in the dressing room? Yeah. But at the same token, at least, you know, 19, 14 year old boys. So you put 19, 14 year old boys together, they're going to do 14 year old boy things. Mm-hmm. You know, and behave like 14-year-old boys in the dressing room, outside the dressing room. You know, I hope they represent themselves, you know, and I always say in a manner that would make your mom proud. You know, rightly or wrongly, that's just, you know, the language that I use, because we don't ever want to embarrass ourselves, right? So can it change? Just like what we were saying, I think it takes time.
Yeah, I think that's appropriate that we see the game moving from, you know, pastime to a way of life. And there's a section in Brandon, in the neighborhood, that they're renaming the streets, so they're going to name the streets after former Wheat King hockey players. So you can start to see how deeply ensconced hockey is within our culture. But one of the things that some of the interviews that I had with former pros, they all played for the same captain, so these were individual interviews. But they said the image of Lanny McDonald as their captain allowed them to be a different kind of man. And I thought, when we provide different images of the person beside us, that you can be that way. This one guy loved me, said, I never thought I could be that way. I could be gentle. I could be kind. I didn't have to have a persona or a bravado. Mm. But I would say, and maybe it'd be interesting, Paul, that when you're in the top six, so if you're a goal scorer, you have a different latitude on how masculine you have to be. If you're on the bottom, third and fourth line, you have a different role to play. So you have these, if you're Sidney Crosby, my job in the fourth line is to protect your space. So you can see that different bodies have different value, which is problematic if you're trying to earn a living and you're being paid quite handsomely for it. So I think your question's a really good one, Jackie, but what's the impetus for change? And there's other structures in society that hold this narrative in place too. I mean, Hollywood has, I mean, there's other places we go that prop up hyper-masculine ideals. It's not just a hockey rink.
Could you look at the military? Like, they had that sort of hyper masculine, but they have done changes to become more inclusive, etc.
I did some work around the military, and they've hired, you know, they've had sensitivity training, and sometimes it's colossal disasters. Okay. You can change the information that's coming in, but changing the being of men, I think it's a longer process.
So that goes back to the resilience. Does the number of women in the game make a change?
When the All-Star game last year, they had women partake in the skills competition. I don't remember the name of the woman who did the skating around the rink, but she was the second fastest time. I'm just wondering the impact of seeing a woman skate a lot faster than a lot of the men who are the top in the profession. If that does start to turn the gaze to what are women doing, and how might we learn from the women's game? Because for a long time, it seemed like the women were trying to, it was the other way around, right? So I'm wondering, I don't know, Paul, if you, when you see women performing in a way that I've, in my lifetime, I've never seen that kind of speed and strength in a woman.
Well, I think, you know, the evolution of the women's game, especially since, when was it, 1990, the first Women's World Championship. So I think we're looking at, you know, two generations of, for lack of a better word, like an elite level women's hockey player. I mean, it's got to make a difference.
That's interesting. Because one of these pros, when I was asking to be part of the research, he said, well, what are you looking for? And I said, well, things like in the dressing room or in the trainer's room that you're making fun of each other for being soft. He says, oh, every day. That's part of our discourse, that we critique each other on playing through injury, playing when you're sick, playing like that's still thing. Like, and these guys were talking about getting you know, quarter zone shots. They need to stay in the lineup. It's their livelihood, right? So there's something that I keep bumping up against is how resilient it is to repel kinds of ways that we might think about it being done differently.
Is the willingness to stay in the lineup, though, like, is there anybody here that's not gone to work when they're feeling under the weather? Like, you know, it's just so happens that, you know, as a teacher, when I'm feeling under the weather, oh, I got a cold, but I still go to work. It's a little bit different than, you know, someone who's a cortisone shot in their shoulder so they can get through the game. But it's still going to work, you know, and still being at less than 100%. I think we all do it, you know, to some respect.
Yeah, I guess it's to one's peril, though, right?
Yeah.
Some of these guys had said, one thing I would have done differently in my career is I would have taken more time off after injury. But can you only see that in retrospect? There's the center to me. It's like, okay, we can talk about these things in the rearview mirror, but when you're living it, you suit it up. And now you've got three back surgeries and memory problems and you're 50. I was part of it, so it's not to, can, you know, say, I can't believe it. I absolutely did that.
You did the same.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah.
You know, hit things from coach or the trainer so that you could get back into the lineup.
Yeah.
100%.
There's in the pros, it's guys who are paying off trainers.
Is it the fear that other people will judge you if you're seen as being soft, or is it more that you really want to be there and you'll do whatever it takes to be on the ice?
Well, for me, I wanted to play. Like, that was it. That's what I wanted to do. And, you know, a little, if I was sore, you know, whatever, you play through it. Because you're still playing. You know, that's ultimately what it was about, was being able to play. And there's nothing worse than, you know, being in the stands for 6 weeks because, you know, you're braced from your hip to your ankle because you've just torn apart your knee. And, you know, so that when you do go to physio, you know, you're maybe not as truthful with them as what you could be, so you can get back
fine,
in the lineup.
It's fine.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Because
you
want to get back in the lineup. I mean, you're part of the team, but you're apart from the team.
Yeah.
And you want to be.
Do you feel like if you're not on the ice, you're not performing, do you feel like you're not part of the team in the same way?
Well, you're missing out something. You're missing part of that experience. Mm-hmm. And I think what a lot of players will say, that one of the things they miss most when they're done hockey is the dressing room experience. And if you're not, right, then you're missing part of the experience of being on a team.
Yeah. And something that I think I've been trying to think through too is that when we play the game, we also get played by the expectation. So it brings in the notion of what does a 17,000 people in a rink do to one? And certain men would say, I'm not going to fight at home because if I lose at home, there's a shame that's magnified because I'm at home in front of my fans. So they would choose to fight more on the road, where the embarrassment and the shame wouldn't be as intense, some of them would say.
So you think like that while you're playing, like you're cognizant of the people who are watching and you might play differently depending?
Well, just the other night in Montreal, home fans were booing Carey Price or jeering him, right, in a night that he wasn't having. So the pressure that they have to live through must, like, can any of us really relate? Because you've got 21,000 people critiquing you at work. I mean, just think of your own experience. If someone comes into, one person comes in to watch you while you're at work, you know, you're a little bit, you want to make sure that you've got everything dialed. Well, that's 21,000 people and you're doing it 40 times, you know, in the span of 6 months. The pressure that those guys must have to deal with would be.
Well, that's back to your guy on the plane, right?
Yeah. Well, and also I think just it kind of made me think about when Don Cherry it was a real intense time where he'd be very critical on European players and continuously berating them about their soft game, et cetera, et cetera. There was a bunch of young men who came over from Europe who played in the Ontario Hockey League. They actually used social media to kind of withstand the onslaught. So this constant barrage of this guy telling us that we have to play this way. And they started to question themselves, like, what are we doing here? And they would say, these guys are a bunch of Neanderthals. Like, they would describe your North American hockey players as Neanderthal cavemen. And they actually hooked up through social media and said, no, we're okay. We got to stay together. So they actually built bonds as a way to, you know, repel this incessant diatribe against the way they were being perceived.
That's fascinating. That's like the brotherhood you were speaking about before, but it's sort of brotherhood within the larger brotherhood to withstand the pressures of the toxic masculinity kind of pressure.
Yeah, and you play hockey differently in Europe, I think. When you think of playing hockey elsewhere, again, this is a possibility, how we play it in North America.
Yeah.
There's other possibilities that Europe, I think, you know, European bigger rinks,
bigger rinks,
fewer games or less games.
I don't think there's necessarily the history of rock'em sock'em hockey that we have in North America, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, Don Cherry made a whole career out of it. But I mean, you go all the way back to the earliest games that were played and, you know, there was always an undercurrent of violence. You know, our games now that we play here in 2019, like, it looks nothing like the game that was played, you know, 100 years ago.
I mean, not to romanticize this, but I grew up on an outdoor rink play. And that's when the play, the adults weren't in the play.
Mm-hmm.
And we played differently.
Differently how?
We worked it out. People didn't usually take penalties. We didn't wear equipment. We'd spend hours at the rink.
Mm-hmm.
I go in to play competitive hockey, and now there's adults shaping and forming the rules. They're not asking me what I think. They're actually, I'm living up to the image that they're aspiring, really articulated. But when we go to, on the outdoor rink, I spent hours there getting along, and we'd have, you know, 10 guys against 10 guys, and you just take the puck. You're being played in a different, you're playing differently.
You know, I think we can still see that, you know, just here in Brandon at the sticks and pucks sessions that they have at the Sportsplex. Yeah, and it's kids just playing hockey.
Right.
There's no referees, no rules, no adults.
Mm-hmm.
But it's funny how at the end, everybody enjoyed the experience. You know, and there was no major conflict, and any conflict was resolved, you know, pretty much with the, you know, the next turn of the skate or whatever, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and every time you score a goal, you'd say, I'm so-and-so, like, I'm Wayne Gretzky, you're the goal scorer. Yeah. You know, one guy I interviewed said he had these aspirations to be a third, fourth line enforcer. They all want to be, the, you know, scoring goals and celebrating and high five. That was, that's the image that we want to aspire. But it becomes a livelihood, it becomes a job. At the next level, they couldn't make it doing that role. So then they found a different role to perform.
Right? And there's all these fans keeping them in that role too, right? If you're not...
Yeah, they read the papers, they hear the media, they're not used to it.
Absolutely.
Now with social media too.
Yeah, they know.
No, we all aspire to be at the top of that, you know, that hierarchy, but, you know, not all of us can do it. I mean, the NHL right now is, what, the 600-odd best in the world, and there's way more than 600 people playing hockey. So
You know, that's, it's interesting too that when I, there's a guy I played junior with, he had made Philadelphia, he was part of the study. When he came into Calgary, I went to see him. He was about 21 years old and I was going to USC. And I said, how is it in the NHL, thinking this must be an awesome
lifestyle?
He
made it.
He said, you know, I'm really not enjoying it. And I said, what do you mean? Like, you're 21, you're a millionaire, what's not to like? He said, they want me to wear two capes on the ice. They want me to be a meathead. And it's against my constitution. And if I continue to do that, I'm going to lose my soul. And I had heard many athletes say that, this notion of soul. So there's, you can just feel what it would like to live doing. And he was 6'4", 230 pounds. So you're framed within a body. You're framed within a particular way you need to play. And he was a gifted junior, like a good hands, nice skater. Could have been otherwise, I think. The GM calls me at the office and says, listen, we don't want you to be that person anymore. He says, by that thought, I had lost my confidence to play any other way. How, like, you know, and you've got to live that. Like, what's it like, that lived experience of a pro hockey player?
You get pigeonholed, and, you know, how do you get out of it? How do you change people's perception of you if you don't get the opportunity? You change that at the risk of your glamorous lifestyle. I mean, you're flying everywhere. You only work a few hours a day, you know, officially. And you get, you're cashing a giant paycheck. So if all of a sudden you want to change who people see or what your perceived position in the hierarchy is, you're putting all of that at risk. You know, and that, is that really a reality for some of these guys? Just like everyone else, you know, they're going to have family obligations and, you know, they're trying to set themselves up because...
Yeah, and it brings in, it begs the question to me that we often see fighting is consensual. I think what Paul has said, it brings that into question. How consensual is it if you feel boxed into the role?
Pressure.
Yeah. So this idea, I think it's a bit of a myth that two men agree to this.
Maybe neither of them do.
I think we can. I think in some instances we can say that they agree to it simply because there's an understanding that this is what they're expected to do. Right? So you have two actors. I go, well, I guess we're going to do this. Yeah, let's do it. I guess that resignation. And we also got to look at not only what you're expected to do, you know, from management, but your teammates, the fans, you know, maybe in some cases your family. Like, who knows what all the push-pull factors for this type of behavior are.
And further to that, what some of the athletes would talk that they would take some of the traits that they would learn on the ice into the boardroom. So I'm thinking, so now there's this notions of patriarchy, not only leaving within the context of an arena, it now extends beyond that community. They would take these, and I don't want to vilify hockey because I think there are many things that I've learned that I'm glad that I embrace certain things, but it becomes toxic and certain hyper-masculine traits go out the bounds. So men committing violent acts, carrying themselves in particular ways that extend beyond the confines of a rink.
Well, that's what we were seeing in the news, right? Like
I think if you talk to most hockey players and ask them to look at, you know, the big picture of their life in hockey, I would suspect that the vast majority are going to find something that they've enjoyed throughout the game and that they would never change, not for anything. Like, I know I would never want to change what I did because it's shaped who I am now. And I think a lot of players, that when they get to the point, you know, when all's said and done and their body is broken down, because it does happen, you know, they can't play the game anymore, they'll look back. And I think you'll always find someone that's got fond memory.
Yeah, right? And I think it's always this and that. Right? It's never just a zero sum. But some of these athletes, one guy said to me, you know, I've never really thought, and this was a college-educated former pro saying, I've never really thought how hockey had shaped me as a husband, a partner, a father, a friend. I'm thinking, that's how it's just part of what we do, right? Yeah. I play that over and over in my mind that you spent your lifetime doing something, and it has its way with you, and you weren't conscious of that.
Person beyond the game.
Yeah.
Like, I think of the closest friends that I have, the vast majority are guys that I played hockey with.
And it shapes you for better or worse, right? Like teamwork, right? Camaraderie, all of the good of things that, too. Sure. Yeah.
And then the same athlete said, I cannot go. They have charity games. He said, I can't go to the charity games because it brings up too much sting. So he was 55, had a great career in the NHL, but he's still living through these things. And that's the part that really interests me, is who do we become because of the experience that we have?
Right.
For good or ill.
Right.
Right. So all bad news.
Right.
Yeah. But it still lingers, right?
Thank you for listening to the Research Connection podcast. You can visit our website for links to everything that was mentioned in the episode. And for more Research Connection content at www.brandonu.ca/bu-cares. Be sure to rate and subscribe so you can stay up to date with current research that impacts your community. Thank you.